Hey guys, Matthew here. So today I'll be bringing you basically the video I said yesterday, which is going to be my economy-based video, which is going to be talking about what I think is going to be the best in terms of making currency, or just what you should and especially what you shouldn't do. I've been watching a fair bit of YouTube videos of just random people. I'm not going to call out anybody, but saying like, oh, do this, you know, this is good ways to make currency, early league, whatever. And a lot of the information is either very suboptimal or sometimes outright completely horrible. So I'm going to tell you a bit of what I think you should do and also what I think you really shouldn't do. I'm going to use MS Paint because that's probably like the best way I can use to explain things. Hopefully you guys can get behind my MS Paint skills, which by the way are pretty low. Either way, so first off, I do want to shout out to myself. Basically, I have a few videos that I put in that I put up on my YouTube right before the beginning of the last league, right before Blight, and I went over basically the different methods that I thought and I still believe are the best ways to make currency in the game, especially early in the league. So I have basically the Path of Exile week one currency guides. So I have a Uber Lab edition. I have a boss killing edition. I have a mapping edition, trading edition, and that's basically like the four things that I believe to be the most optimal when it comes to making currency, especially early. Obviously, some of them will range from you need to know a lot about the games. For example, if you want to be a trader, right? If you want to do some trading, you're going to have to know quite a bit about the game because it's not something that's really easy to do with absolutely no knowledge. So, for example, if it's your first or second league or something and you haven't really put in too much time and research into the game, probably not something for you. That being said, if you're somebody who really enjoys doing the same thing over and over and over again, lab running, my Uber Lab Edition is probably something that'll be very, very useful to you. Because I believe, still to this day, that lab running is the best way to make currency in the first week of a league. I'll say it again. That being said, it requires you to do the same thing over and over and over again, and as soon as you become inefficient with it, so as soon as your, let's say, 4 to 5 minute lab runs start becoming 6 to 7 minutes and you're missing trades because you're not being fast enough and people don't want to wait and stuff like that, then it can very quickly become nowhere near as good as, you know, the best way to make currency. But if you can be efficient with it and you can, you know, just zoom through these labs as fast as possible. Also, remember to use PoE Lab Compass, but I explained everything in that video. Probably the best way to make currency, especially as a solo player. So let me get this right. Especially as a solo player. Labbing doesn't require anybody to be with you. All it requires is for you to just do the same thing over and over and over again. Then we have the Boss Killing Edition. This one, again, pretty good when it comes to solo play because you can offer carries and stuff. The thing is, in the upcoming league, it's a boss killing league, so I'm expecting a lot of people to be playing very high single target damage builds or builds that can deal with bosses very, very easily. Therefore, I don't think boss killing is going to be necessarily the way to make currency in terms of offering carries and stuff like that. I still think if you're going to be starting off this league, you're going to want a build that can actually do all the content in the game, including bosses, because from the look of the patch notes, it seems that they are really pushing the player base towards killing bosses. They're giving us, obviously, last league, we had the addition of master missions that are rewarded upon killing bosses, like the bosses in the map. So that's one reason why you should kill all your bosses, is to stack upon these master missions, because they gain value over time for sure, and they allow you to, you know, actually sustain your maps and all that good stuff, allow you to delve, you can sell them, anything you want, really. So master missions are really good. Now they're also adding that basically the bosses will be dropping the catalyst, if I understood that correctly. And for your build your own boss type for the league, the Metamorph League, they're also making it so basically the harder the bosses that you choose when you're building your own boss, the more rewards you get. So you're going to want to use, you know, map bosses, not just random rares in your map or something. I'm not sure who's going to drop the catalyst, but if I understood properly, it's like all the rares in the maps or something, or all the special rares or whatever, and then the map boss as well. I'm not entirely sure. Another reason why you really want to kill bosses this league is, from my understanding, the special plus skill gems. Like, for example, I don't know, added cold plus, or well, I think they're called awakened now, right? So, like, awakened added cold damage or something. From my understanding, those skill gems are only going to drop from the Conquerors, which is the five new bosses. So, if that's the case, then you really want to be killing bosses, because I think those skill gems are going to be very expensive. I'm expecting a level 1 no quality of those gems, like, right off the bat when it drops, to be worth more than a level 21, 23 of any skill gem. So, for example, if you get a elemental damage with attack skills, plus, if it even is one of the possibilities, and the elemental damage with attack skills 21-23 is like 5x, I'm expecting these ones to be even more expensive. Obviously, though, it depends how rare they are. If they aren't as rare as I'm expecting, then that could be completely false, and maybe we're just going to get flooded with those gems. But I'm expecting them to be pretty rare. There's also the Awakener's Orb for fusing, to fuse influences, to have items with multiple influences. That also points towards killing bosses. It's called the Awakener Orb, so I'm guessing it's going to drop only from the Awakener, which is a new endgame boss. And if that's the case, then you're going to want to be able to kill, you know, that dude. Otherwise, you'll have to pay services to kill him, just kind of like Uber Elder, or Elder, or whatever, or Shaper. And I'm expecting those services to be fairly expensive. Obviously, it depends. If a lot of people are playing builds that can actually do it, then people are probably just going to undercut each other on the prices, and it's going to go pretty cheap. But if only a select amount of people can actually do these bosses because they're actually super hard, then we'll have to see. Anyways, so I recommend playing a build that's good to kill bosses. Then I had my mapping edition. That's going to stay true. That always stays true. Pushing to maps and just chain mapping with prophecies, with map mods and all that stuff is always going to be good. It's always just a good way to make currency. Ever since they nerfed the magic find, low tier mapping is not so great. So you want to juice your maps. You want to use your chisels. You want to Alk and Val every single map you do. Starting in yellow maps, you don't want to start, you know, chiseling white maps, or probably not even chiseling yellow maps, but you do want to Alk and Val every single yellow map you do, because it has a chance of going plus one, and then that's obviously a good thing when it goes plus one, because it allows you to reach the end game of the Atlas quicker. So there's that. Oh, another thing is the Watchstones, which are used to basically upgrade all the maps in a certain region of the Atlas, as far as I can understand, only also drop from the Conquerors, which are the new bosses. So you want to be able to kill the bosses if you want to be able to actually access, like, the full T14 to 16 Atlas strat, or whatever your strategy is. I'm guessing the Watchstones are only going to drop from the bosses, therefore you got to be able to kill them. Otherwise, you're going to have to pay for some carries. And obviously, the trading. If you're somebody who's going to be going for trading, you probably don't need me to tell you how it's done. Otherwise, you're probably going to fail as a trader. Trading is something that requires a lot of game knowledge. It requires a lot of research. It requires you to know what's going on in the game, what the meta is, what people are willing to pay for. Because even if something is meta and you're crafting for these people or flipping for what these people want and whatever, or should want, if they don't want it, if they're not willing to pay the price for whatever it is, then you're going to fail as well. So trading is definitely not something that's easy. It's probably one of the hardest part of the entire game, because obviously it's all done outside of the game. It's not like killing monsters. Anybody can kill monsters. When it comes to trading, it's much different, and it requires a little bit more knowledge. And when I say knowledge, it's really just research. Like, you're not reinventing the wheel. I'm not reinventing the wheel. My entire database, my entire filters that I made, all of this stuff I made, none of it's new. I didn't come up with anything. I just copied it from other people. So it's more a question of doing the proper research than actually trying to figure out new ways, right? The game has been out for years. People have been doing this for years. There's no reason to change a recipe if it's already successful. So that's my thoughts on that. Anyways, so this brings me to my MS Paint. MS Paint, little document here. Gotta go ahead and reset it. So this is basically going to be my way of explaining things that you should and shouldn't do when it comes to currency making. So I'm gonna try to make this as easy and quick as quick as possible. I do realize that my face is hiding a little bit of it though, so I'm gonna try to like do a little box around my face so I'm sure that I don't actually put anything in this box. There we go. So I'm gonna start off with one thing, lab running. I think that's okay. That's okay, and that's actually okay, quite okay. But like I said, it really depends on you as a person. If you know that you're not somebody who can like do the same thing over and over and over and over again, and not get bored, it's not something for you. But if you're somebody who's capable of just fucking blasting through labs over and over and just keep going, lab is going to be very profitable because I don't expect that many people to be labbing this league. The reason for that is that the new Atlas, the new content, the new league mechanic, all of this stuff is a lot more appealing to the player base. Therefore, the people who are like, "I'm just going to go lab," instead they're just going to do everything else. And the only people who are going to be farming lab are the true lab farmers, people like Keed, people like Carlos, stuff like that. The people who always farm lab every single league, because that's kind of like who they are and as players and what they enjoy. Those people are going to make mad money. If you want to be alongside those people, I recommend you just find yourself a little guide on YouTube or something like a lab runner build. I think I personally have one on my channel as well. You can also Google Keed lab running build. I'll just link it in the description, or sorry, in the comment section of the video, so you guys can just have a look since I already know where it is. So lab is going to be good. Mapping is good. Mapping is really good. Obviously, this league you're going to want to probably go fast when it comes to mapping. I'd say skip magic finding altogether. Just go as high as possible, as fast as possible. Now, my predictions when it comes to map sales is that you're going to be awkward. The reason why is because normally you'd have, let's say, four T1 maps, right? Four T1 maps. That's a T. Four T1 maps. Then you'd have like, let's say, six T2 maps. Then you had so on so forth. And at the end of the Atlas, you'd have four T16s, right? So the idea was that it was like a little bit of a funnel, right? And it started off fairly large, and it was getting like smaller and smaller as you progress through the Atlas. And the faster you got to the end of the Atlas, then all these maps in the funnel, you could sell to people who were still at the beginning of the funnel, right? So it was amazing when it came to like pushing Atlas super fast and selling maps, because people wanted the progression, wanted the Atlas bonus, and wanted to reach the end of the Atlas. Therefore, they had to buy maps that they weren't dropping themselves, or they had to buy maps if they wanted to keep going, or if they got stuck. Let's say they got a they had like five maps of a certain tier, like five red maps. They run all five, no red map drops. They gotta go buy red maps to try to keep going through their Atlas. Now, the problem is this league that the funnel is kind of the opposite way. You start, well, it's not even the opposite way, it's just kind of linear. So you're gonna start off with let's say this line, right, which is gonna be whatever. And then the rest of the Atlas is basically a line that is the exact same. So you start off with the Atlas and you have like so many maps discovered. I think it's 55 or whatever maps that you can actually see. I don't know how many are T1, T2. I didn't really look. But either way, you're going to start off with this. And at the very end, instead of being four T16s, you're going to have like 150 T14 to 50 to 16s. So all these maps that people would normally buy in the funnel, right? To reach these four T16s as fast as possible to get their Elder Orb to start farming one specific map, which was a strategy for pretty much everybody except people who farm Shaper. They're no longer gonna have to buy your maps because they're gonna do all their T1 maps and all their T2 and all their T3, T4, T6, whatever. And if they ever get stuck, the thing is they're just gonna be able to like upgrade a part of their Atlas, right, to a higher tier, which is using the watchstones, that is, and then that's going to drop them the maps that they're missing that are lower tier. And you can do that literally, they said, like mid mapping session. Like you it's literally just one click for the watchstone to upgrade and degrade all your maps in that region. So For people who normally make a lot of currency from just pushing the Atlas really, really quickly and selling maps, I think those people are probably going to be very surprised at how bad mapping sells are going to be this league. And the reason for that is simple enough. You used to have, like I said, you used to have like 4 T1s, 6 T2s, whatever, and then maybe 6 T3s, and so on and so forth, up to your 4 T16s, which is what I already explained. The thing is, this league, what's going to happen is there's no longer 4 T1s. There's maybe, well, actually, maybe there's going to be 4 T1s, but let's say in the higher-ish tier, like, let's say yellow tier, instead of getting, like, 6 T8 maps, 6 different T8 maps, you're going to have, like, 6 T8s, but you're also going to have, like, all the the T3s or T4s upgrading into T8s, right, from your different regions of your Atlas using the Watchstones. So in the end, the amount of T8 maps you're actually going to be able to run is going to be like fucking 50, right? Or I don't know how many exactly, obviously, like I said, I'm not there yet. But all I know is that there's going to be so many different maps, right, available on the market, that selling maps, and especially selling specific maps, is going to be really, really hard. Another thing is people used to be able to set up their Atlas to where they would only drop one specific map of every single tier, and they would farm a tier much higher. So for example, if you farmed, a T8 map, whatever, and there's a specific T4, let's say Burial Chamber, that was worth a lot more than even some of the T8, T9, T10 maps, you could set up your Atlas to where you would only ever drop Burial Chambers if a T4 dropped while you were farming T8, so that would happen fairly often. That's also going to be gone because of how the Atlas is going to require you to basically upgrade different sections of it. So it's either going to be outright gone. Yeah, it's going to be gone because I think they're removing cartographer seals and stuff. So we're no longer going to be able to actually remove maps from the Atlas, if I understood this correctly, which that would be pretty bad. Because then the moment you've completed a map, you can no longer ever remove it. All you can do is actually upgrade that section of the Atlas, which, no, there's no way, right? There's got to be a way to actually be able to just do one specific map. I'm not sure. Or not one specific map, sorry, but removing maps from the Atlas. Because if you can remove maps from the Atlas, you'll still be able to actually permafarm one specific map. It's not going to be easy, but it's going to be doable. The question is, can we actually remove maps that we complete? Because hear me out on this. Let's say you start with a quadrant of the Atlas that is this big, and it has this map, this map, this map, this map, this map, this map, right? And the map you want to farm is this one. So, and it starts off as, let's say, a T3, right? And it's going to finish as a T16 once you're done upgrading it all the way through with the Watchstones. The thing that you could do is you farm all of these maps, you finish all of them, right? Then you upgrade all of this, you upgrade the entire section, upgrade. Now, this map, instead of being a T3, it becomes a T7 or something, right? Then you complete all of these maps again. You upgrade it again. Now, instead of being a T7, it's, I don't know, like a T11 or something. Then you can recomplete everything, right? Then at the very end, it becomes, let's say, a T16. And then you remove all the other maps using what used to be Cartographer's Seal. Like I said, I don't know if they're still going to be available. If they are, though, in some way, shape, or form, you can remove all these other maps, and the only map you'll be left in your quadrant, right, is going to be the one you want to farm, your specific T16, and then since the cartographer sextants no longer apply to specific maps, but instead apply to the whole region, you're still going to be able to juice the fuck out of this map alone, even if all the other ones, let me use another color, it's getting crowded in here. This map alone, even if all the other maps are actually no longer part of your Atlas. The question is, can we or can we not remove certain maps from the Atlas? I think we can't, because they said they're changing how cartographers work, and because it used to be like, is basically a recipe from the Shaper, right? Unshaping orb, and then they had cartographer seals. And I think I read in the patch notes that they removed that. But I could be mistaken. And if I am mistaken, then farming one single map is still going to be possible via what I just explained. I think. That's what I think. So, we have lab. Lab is good. Mapping is good. Another thing that's going to be good is going to be trading. Trading. Flipping. Flipping. Those are also going to be good. Those are always good. Then we're going to open a new file. Then we also have crafting. Crafting. That's going to be very good. We've got ourselves a crafting league on our hand. That being said, the crafting meta is changing. The crafting meta used to be you alt spam. You alt spam. That's really ugly. Okay. You used to alt spam into two stats. Right? And then you would regal. And then annul. And then multi-mod. That was the old meta when it came to crafting. Now they're changing all of this because you can only multi-mod two mods that are not the multi-mod itself. So it means that your crafting items need at least three stats to be viable. So what does this change? This changes basically the meta of crafting. What I mean by that is that alt-spamming is not going to be dead. Alt-spamming is going to be fine. The thing is, you're going to have to reset way more, right? Because if you alt-spam and you hit a bad regal and then you annul the bad regal, and then you don't even need to annul, right? That's a difference. Is let's say you're alt-spamming and then you regal, you hit a bad regal. You can't just annul the bad regal and say, all right, I'm a multi-mod it. If you do that, you're going to end up with a 5-stat item, and then you're going to have to either slam it for 6th mod, or sell it as a 5-mod item, which is going to be obviously very subpar, depending obviously on the other rolls on the item. That being said, we do have access to all these new exalted orbs. So all these 5-stat items, in my opinion, what people should do is slam them with the new exalts, hoping for something new that nobody has, right? Or something really good that's from the mod pools of the new conquerors. And then that could finish your item. Obviously, if you slam something horrible, then you're kind of out of options. You can try to annul, you can just sell it and hope that somebody wants the item for all the other stats on there, or whatever. That being said, what I'm expecting, you've heard it here first, but what I'm expecting is this to be a chaos spam league. Right? So this is going to be a chaos spam league, which in turns means exalts should be expensive. When exalts are expensive, chaos spamming is actually really, really good. The reason is that when you're chaos spamming, you have a chance at anything, right? You could get a 61 item, you could get garbage, you could get whatever. The reason why I think chaos spamming is going to be good is because chaos spamming has a higher chance than alt spamming because you're getting more mods at once, right? And then how you fix chaos spamming is simple. You beastcraft. By using beastcrafting, then you can fix chaos spamming because it allows you to remove, let's say, a bad affix. So let's say a bad prefix or a bad suffix. It allows you to completely remove that from the item. Obviously, it's a gamble, though. But beastcrafting on top of chaos spamming is probably going to be like the new method of crafting. People are going to take like one item, right, from a certain influence, an item from another influence. They're going to fuse them together and get a doubled influence item. And then from there on, the only real way to craft it, other than obviously fossil crafting, if you have something specific in mind, if you're just going for the most possible mods at once and the highest possible chance of getting something good, chaos spamming is going to be the way to go. And then beastcrafting into a 3-stat base. 3-stat base. So 3 prefixes or 3 suffixes. And then metacrafting it into a 6-mod item. Well, a 5-mod. And then you probably just mod out the last stat. Which are basically going to be mirror tier item. And the reason why I'm talking about mirror tier item and stuff that is way more advanced and like expensive is because we are going to be basically going into a brand new meta. They removed essentially Shaper and Elder mods from the game. They nerfed Shaper and Elder mods so bad that I don't think they're that worth it anymore, which means the new influences are going to have to make up for that, which means that we're kind of in a place, I wouldn't say as good as Sinsys, because Sinsys was kind of OP, but we're definitely entering a new meta of crafting. So if you're the first person to hit something that's amazing, and nobody else has anything like it, you're gonna be insanely rich if the demand for that is high. Because it's brand new and nobody knows exactly how things are done yet. So take advantage of the fact that people don't know, and take advantage of the fact that you get lucky sometimes. And obviously, if you don't get lucky, that's also gonna happen. But either way, I think crafting is gonna be really good. So that's what I was going through with all these documents. Now, how would I th what do I recommend in terms of getting currency early in the league? Like early, like I'm talking day one, day two. Here's what I said I was going to talk about at the very beginning of the video. So what you want to do is get yourself a fast build, right? Get yourself a fast build and get to maps as fast as possible. Even like I said, if maps are not necessarily going to be the easiest thing to sell this league, probably, at least that's what I'm expecting, because it's really weird how the Atlas works now. And it's a lot more flexible, basically, how the new Atlas works. Therefore, it's a lot easier to get all the things you need. You should still get to maps as fast as possible, because maps are basically like leveling zones with quantity, with quality, with pack size, with rarity, with magic pack size, with additional monsters, with sextants, with prophecies. Like, maps are basically like 10 times better than any zone you can think of, because you're able to juice them as much as you personally want. So you want to get to maps as fast as possible. Now, to do that, you're going to want a good build. If you want a good build, I'd recommend probably just looking at literally all the other YouTubers about PoE right now. They're all making starter builds for Path of Exile. I'll link one in the comment section as well, alongside Keed's build for his lab runner. So I'll do that, but there's millions of videos right now that are coming out just about like, oh, builds for 3.9 starter league. So get to maps as fast as possible. That's going to be the number one thing you can do to make currency if you're like not necessarily new to the game. Even if you're advanced at the game, whatever who you are, this is going to be the best way to make currency. Because if you're thinking about flipping, especially as a solo player, early in the league, like I'm talking day one, day two, forget it. Flipping is not going to be good. Flipping is never good. And the reason for that is because nobody needs anything, right? People don't need anything. People are trying to level up. People are trying to get to maps. So they're not going to buy your well-rolled unique item. They're not going to buy your four stat jewels or anything like that, right? They're not gonna buy any of that. So forget about flipping and trading for now, and just try to get to maps as fast as possible. Of course, if you see something very cheap that happens to pop up from your whoops or something, go ahead and buy it and sell it way later in the league when it's actually worth it. And by way later, I mean like day four, day five, when people start having currency. Now, after watching all these videos that I said had very suboptimal or outright bad information, here's a couple things that you should not do, right? So if you've considered this or some of these things as stuff you should do or you could do, I'm going to tell you right now, these strategies are extremely bad. Don't do this. You will be literally shooting yourself in the feet and regretting it, like real bad. So one of the common thing that people are talking about right now is, let me put this much higher, much bigger. One of the things people are talking about right now is farming mud flats. People are talking farming mud flats because you can get the Lion Div card. The Lion Div card gets you a lionized item, which could be the lionized fall jewel, the lionized glitter bow, the chest piece, the paws, and the shield, right? This is bad, okay? I'm sorry, But from the stats that I've heard of and seen in the videos that people are talking about this, they're saying you can get something like 2 sets per hour, or 3 sets per hour, or even 4 sets per hour, because it's only a set of 4 cards, so it's pretty easy to complete a set, right? The problem is, this is weighted. It's not a 1 in 5 chance to get a lionized fall. It's not a 1 in 5 chance to get a lionized glare. This is weighted, right? And the problem is that it's always weighted towards the bad stuff that nobody cares about. Like the chess piece, for example. The chess piece is like 1 awk, maybe 1 C, right? Imagine farming something for an hour. You get 3 sets, you turn them in, you get 2 chess pieces and a shield. The chess pieces are worth 1 C each, the shield is worth 2 C. Let's just call it 2 C, right? You just made 4 C in 1 hour. That is awful, right? Even in the first day of a league. The reason why this is awful is simple. You can just get to Blood Aqueducts instead and farm Chaos Recipe, and you're probably going to make like 30, 40 chaos per hour, right? Maybe not as much because you'll probably get bottlenecked by jewelry, especially amulets. But even again, this brings me to my next point. Another thing you should not do is farming Blood Aqueduct. Aqueducts. I think that's how you write it. It might be aqueducts. I'm not sure. No, it's got to be an E. Either way, this looks really weird. It's probably an A. Either way, farming blood aqueducts, and the reason for that is because humility cards, right? The card for the tabula card. The thing about it, the tabula card, early in the league, and actually for the entire league pretty much, are 2 C each, right? It's 2 chaos for a humility card. They really nerfed the drop rate of humility card in Blood Aqueducts. It used to be fairly easy to farm yourself a tabula, take maybe an hour or two. More like 2 hours solo. That being said, nowadays it's pretty fucking long to get yourself a tabula solo unless you get lucky. The thing about this is that 2 chaos is literally 1 chaos recipe, which is 2 rings, 1 amulet, 1 belt, amulet, 2 weapons, 2 weapons, chest, boots, helmet, and gloves that are rare, right? So I'm gonna tell you right now, you are much more likely to get 2 rings, a belt, an amulet, 2 weapons, a chest, boots, and helmet, and gloves that are rare in maps than to get a humility card. You're probably going to get at the very least 1 set of Chaos Recipe every map or every other map, especially in the early stages of a league. Let's say T1, T2, T3 maps when you're using transmutes before you start awking them, right? You might have an issue. You might have issues getting amulets or rings because they're fairly rare when you're just transmuting your maps. But when you start awking your maps, trust me, you're pretty much going to get at the very least 1 full Chaos Recipe per map. And one map probably takes like what? 3 to 4 minutes for most builds to clear. 3 to 4 minutes. So in 3 to 4 minutes, you're going to get like 1 or 2 chaos recipe, which is going to be on average 3 chaos per map, plus everything else, versus farming humility cards that are going to be worth like 2 chaos, right? And sometimes even go down to 1.5 chaos for people that are desperate to sell them early in the league, like day one, that is. So what you should do instead is farm maps, do the chaos recipe, buy the humility cards, get yourself a tabula, then keep buying humility cards, get other tabulas, and flip the tabulas. Because the thing is, the tabula is 9 cards that are 2C each, which means it's going to cost you 18C for a tabula, right? On day one of a league, if you're buying the cards for 2C each. You can actually sell the tabula for upwards of 25C plus if you get there early enough. Right? So the difference here is at the very minimum 7 chaos, and it can be even higher, obviously, depending how much you can sell them for. And that kind of depends on the league. Sometimes you can sell them all the way up to 30 chaos, which you could be like, well, that's only 7 chaos, right? It's not the end of the it's not that great. Well, the thing is, those 7 chaos are basically free, and 7 chaos in that stage of a league is a lot. Because chaos is worth a ton, right? Like 7 chaos on the first day of a league is almost 1/4 of an exalt, right? it's not quite one fourth of an exalt because they're going to be more like 40c each. But that's not going to stay for long. I'm talking the first hours. I'm not talking about like the first 3 days right now. I'm talking about the first hours of a league, like hours 0 to 6 or something. That's the prices you can expect. So, farming blood aqueducts, just no, dude, don't do it. It's farming mudflats, hell no. Farming blood aqueducts, don't do it. Just get to maps as fast as possible, right? And obviously, if you're trying to farm Uber Lab, the faster you get to maps, the faster you find your trials, the faster you can get to farming Uber Lab, and stuff like that. So that's basically 35 minutes for me to say that if you have something specific in mind, you should probably just check out my videos on my YouTube that I have a series on, because I explained literally everything that I could. And when it comes to really early strategy, like I'm talking day one strategy to make currency, you really just need to push to maps. Like there's no secret behind it. I've been baited by farming blood aqueducts many leaks because I thought it was what everybody did, right? I was watching streamers and that's what they were doing. But then like 2 leagues ago or so, I realized that streamers, for the most part, are not currency driven whatsoever, right? They just do it for whatever content they're going for. So if you're currency driven, if you want to have a successful league start and you want to get to the end game as fast as possible, fuck the blood aqueducts farming. And this is, by the way, is for softcore trade league. I'm not talking about solo self-found. Of course, if you're solo self-found, farm blood aqueducts. If you're hardcore, maybe farm blood aqueducts because you want way better gear. But if you're softcore and you're in trade league, fuck the blood aqueducts stuff. Fuck the mudflats farming. That's awful, dude. Just get to maps. Start selling uniques and stuff like that that people are willing to pay like 10 plus times the price of what they're actually worth, because you're going to be the first one there. If you get to maps in like 4 to 5 hours, even 6 hours is respectable, right? If you get to maps in like 6 hours and you start selling uniques that are typically one alk, right? I'm talking like garbage uniques. People are going to pay multiple chaos for these uniques because they need them for their builds, and there's no other ones available. So if you're the first one there, I was talking with Ty when we were in the Brittany private league earlier, I think it was last month or something, and he dropped a Cherubim's Malefiance or something. I can't remember the exact name of the unique. It's like a 1C unique, and I asked him like, how much do you normally ask for this? And he was like, if I'm the first one to get it, 20C. 20 chaos for a garbage unique that's not linked or anything. Like, it's not linked, it's got nothing on it, it's literally just a 1C unique, but since nobody else has it, right, and Toxic Rain is always a popular build on League Start, so people are going to buy it, 20 chaos. That is a lot of currency to be spending on such a horrible item. Well, it's not horrible, it's actually pretty good, but, I mean, it's a 1C unique come day 3, right? And it's this, the same thing holds true for just about everything. So it's about really, really getting there quickly and offering to people things that they have no access to since they're still like stuck in the campaign or in really low tier maps and you're already way ahead of them. So rush to maps. Now the second thing, there's a last thing I want to talk about when it comes to making currency early league is setting up whoops. So you know when you're watching Q-Dog and you hear whoop, that's a whoop. And what whoops are is basically live searches. And obviously if you've been following this channel, you probably know what live searches are because that's like all I talk about. But you want to whoop items with life and resistances. And if it's boots, movement speed. That is it. If you want to be trading early and like flipping items, all you care about are items with life, resistances, and if it's boots, also movement speed. That's it. Nothing else matters in the first day of a league or the first 2 days of a league. People just want life because they want to stay alive, they want res because they want to stay alive, and they want movement speed because that allows them to move faster. That's it. They don't care about this crit chance, crit multi, 6-stat amulet with physical damage to attacks. They don't care about any of this crap. All people care about is life, res, and move speed. So if you're somebody who's going to be making trade filters, or who has already made them and who has them available, and you're going to want to whoop items to resell, you want to buy items with basically life and resistances, and then you want an open prefix or suffix to craft an additional stat and resell, unless, of course, it's already fully modded with good stats and it's just cheap. Then you can also do that. But let's say an item pops up. I'll open up a new one. Let's say an item pops up with 60 life and 40 cold res, right? 40 cold res, 35 fire res, and an empty suffix. An empty suffix, right? So let's say this is a pair of gloves. So this is a pair of gloves with 60 life and 75 cold res. And let's say somebody is selling that for, I don't know, 2 chaos, right? Then you can buy this item. You can craft a 20-20 res, which is a hybrid resistance of double resistances. So for example, 20 cold, 20 fire res, which is an additional 40 resistance, plus the actual 75 that was already on there. Meaning this item has 115 resistance. Let's say this is a ring, right? Let's say this is a ring. Now you can sell this ring, which has 60 life, 115 resistance that you bought for 2C, for probably upwards of over 1 exalt. Maybe even more. It really depends on when that happens in the league, like how early that is, and also if somebody happens to need those resistances that also happen to have an exalt available. So maybe an exalt is a little bit expensive. But 115 res and 60 life on a ring, super early in a league, that is money. And you can get these for like 2C, because people don't think about crafting an additional stat, right? They just pick up the item, they use a price macro, the price macro says, oh, this shit sucks. It's like only 70 res and 60 life, that's just worth 2C. Yeah, alright, 2C. Then you're like, wait, buddy. Like, the price macro doesn't realize there's an empty suffix on there, so I'm gonna go ahead and buy that. If you don't know how to look up for empty suffixes and stuff, I just made a video recently about how to use different functions on the PoE trading website to make your own filters. And empty suffix modifier and empty prefix modifiers are both available on the API search. So there's that. Alrighty, 42 minutes of me rambling about currency making. That's probably all the tips I can give you guys. I know I've been speaking for a long time. And, I mean, I tried to keep it as precise as I could. I'm sorry about the paint skills. I'm really bad at this. This wasn't, like, scripted or anything, but I don't think I rambled on too much. That's pretty much all the information you need. At the very least, this is all the information I am personally going to use as I play the game tomorrow. Like, all this information is the exact same thing I'll be doing and the exact same way I'll be thinking. So obviously, if you know things I don't, go ahead and let me know in the comment section, because I'm always on the lookout to learn more about, you know, different currency generation methods and stuff like that. So I do want to say a huge thanks to my patrons, which are these boys that you see on stream. We got Drool, Mr. Casticus, Mr. Coffee, General XDC, ChemPlay, and Sinsys, and also Fix, Enumag, Kai, Khara, SDiablo. And, well, it would appear that we are missing somebody here, so let me draw his name on here. We've got our man, KFish, as well. So, huge thank you to all you guys. Oh, I can't write anymore, dude. Dude, what the heck? Oh, I'm not on the picture. Alright. Huge thanks to all these boys for the support. If you want to be added to that list, check out my Patreon or check me out on Twitch. I will be starting to stream full time starting basically tomorrow, 8+ hours every single day. So hopefully I get to see you beautiful people around there. And that's gonna be Matthew signing out. Until the next one, peace, good luck, have a good league start, and I'll catch you guys on Twitch.